couple more people hopping in, which I love to see. Thank you guys for joining us, of course, as always. Very excited to talk about one of my favorite topics, scary movies and zombies. I love zombies. So pretty excited to discuss that with you guys today. A couple of smaller housekeeping things before we do start to jump into stuff. This webinar is recorded and will be recorded, and so it will be up live on YouTube later on after it's gone through our process for kind of editing and tweaking and all that good stuff. And other than that, we also have the chat available for you guys to go ahead and put anything you want there as well. And we also have the Q&A feature active for this. So feel free to type some questions into the QA as we go. We'll kind of address most of those towards the end, unless there's something that's really burning and I noticed that it might fit, then we might go ahead and jump in and answer it a little bit sooner. You could also put your questions in chat if you don't mind. It's totally up to you where you want to do it, or if you have any questions or comments or anything like that that you'd like to add as we go. We love to make these kind of interactive, so please let us know your thoughts as we discuss some of these kind of scary movies and what ones you like and don't like and what you think is kind of amusing or funny about them as well. That being said, we're going to kind of go ahead and start discussing these sort of things. So I want to start out by kind of introducing myself, and then I'll let Lauren briefly introduce herself as well. But so I'm Kim Hazel. I have a master's in public health specializing in infectious disease epidemiology. Sorry, having a little bit of a technical glitch here. But so one of my favorite things to talk about is infectious diseases in general. And I really like zombies and the fact that that all kind of goes together, which is super interesting to me, and how kind of Hollywood portrays it, I think is very fun. One of my other favorite areas of kind of study and expertise is infectious diseases history and sort of some of the nitty gritty of like, how did epidemiology become a field and how did infectious diseases start to become something that people are so fascinated with and that sort of thing. So with that, I'm going to pass it to Lauren to let her introduce herself, and I'm going to try to fix this little technical glitch that we're having with the chat.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Like Kim said, she's going to try to enable that chat. I'm Lauren Bergler. I am the account manager here at Gideon. I graduated actually just back in May with a degree in biochemistry, and I've always been very passionate about healthcare and science, so I was very excited when I found Gideon. My role here is to introduce our wonderful platform to new faces and support our current customers in any way possible. So because it's October, it's spooky season, we're going to be talking about infectious diseases and bioterror in Hollywood, and specifically what filmmakers tend to get right and what they tend to get very, very wrong. And even though the accuracy may be lacking a little bit in some of these films, we still love them and we hope that you guys do too. So I'm very grateful. This is my first webinar and I get to co-host it with the brilliant Kim Hazel. I've been very grateful to work with her and I've known her for many years. So I'm going to pass it back to her so she can get our discussion started and hope that she can get the chat back on so you guys can drop your favorite scary movies and anything else you want to talk about.
Yes. Okay. Oh, I should have the chat working now. Sorry about that. A little technical glitch right here in the beginning. So if you still want to take the time to let us know your favorite movie and where you're joining us from, please do that. We love to see that in the chat as well as we go here. But the first thing that I always kind of like to think about and talk about when it comes to infectious disease movies or zombie movies in general is everybody likes to pick Ebola. I don't know if you guys have noticed this trend, but I absolutely have. I think Ebola is one of those things that there's something about it with the name recognition that a lot of people have, because it was in the news kind of more recently, that I think it makes for really compelling stories when it comes to Hollywood film and TV and things like that. I think that people really get like freaked out by the idea, but also the fact that it's kind of a hemorrhagic fever. The idea of any hemorrhagic fever is very scary. And aside from the fact that, you know, as medical professionals or infectious disease professionals, we understand like kind of what the terms and the terminology mean that surround it. I think for the general public, it's even scarier because it's not entirely clear what that could mean or what that means for your body or how that stuff works. And I think that kind of leads us into a weird place of people being kind of nervous about it or kind of scared about it just on the basis of sort of not understanding it fully and that sort of thing. One of the things that also makes Ebola a really good candidate for these type of movies is just the fact that the way that it spreads, right? And the way that it spreads is so special to it and unique to it that, you know, it kind of lends itself to these things. Also, interesting fact about Ebola, it was one of the diseases that inspired the entire genre of zombie movies, because there was actually an outbreak that took place in the Caribbean that actually showed people catching these hemorrhagic fevers, or like Ebola specifically at the time, from dead bodies, from the bodily fluids and the bloods of a dead body. And that led people to kind of come up with this idea of like, oh, okay, let's really dig into like what actual like zombies are going to look like, and what are they going to be like in film and TV, and how can we make them just like very interesting to people and also very scary, and tap into that morbid curiosity that I think everyone kind of has. Also, one of the things with Ebola and other diseases like it, being zoonotic or having spillover from species to species, totally lends itself to some very beautiful Hollywood magic, I think. I think that it's really important that, you know, you can kind of show the audience where this came from, but also it gives them that like, oh, this could happen to me. This is like a freak accident that this thing happened, and now there's this unknown illness, and it's gonna get me. And I think that that also makes people very fascinated, and also taps in again to that morbid curiosity like I was talking about. And people like to be on the edge of their seats, and I think that Ebola is typically the pick for that. But we do have a really awesome way to look at Ebola and get more information about it within Gideon. And so Lauren's going to kind of show us some of those features and some of the things that we can see in Gideon that can also help us go, oh, that's why that's a really good pick for some of these scary movies. So I'm going to toss it back over to Lauren and let her kind of walk us through some of Gideon's really awesome features, how you can dig into these diseases. And you can use this for any infectious disease movie you see. A lot of them use rabies or anthrax as well. And we do have those within Gideon as well. So you can pop in and take a look at the different things through Gideon this way.
Yeah, thanks, Kim. Like I said, part of my role is to show off our platform. So it's my favorite thing to do. And here we go. We're going to go into the Explore module. And into diseases. So you could either type in Ebola here if you wanted to, you know, just type that in, or if you wanted to look at zoonotic diseases and maybe that the vehicle is like direct physical contact for Ebola, you can see that we have 44 diseases that match that, and Ebola is obviously one of them. So here we are, we can see the summary of Ebola. We see the agent, reservoir, incubation period, the therapies used, vaccines, all sorts of information. We also have some great photos from outbreaks, as well as like under the microscope, which I do love. We also have clinical findings and other information on other outbreaks and in different cases that have happened. So if I go back up to the top here, we also have our interactive outbreaks map. And this is awesome because, like I said, it's completely interactive. This is newer on our platform. And we can scroll into where Ebola is endemic, and we can see that each one of these bubbles represents an outbreak. So I can scroll in and you'll start to see the bubbles dispersing at where that particular outbreak occurred. We can even scrolling back out a little bit, we can change the year if we want to just look in the past 22 years and look around and see how that's changed a little bit. So this is also really cool for anyone to look at. And because Ebola is a category A disease, it has a bioterror note as well in Gideon, which we can read. And as Kim mentioned, obviously movies use this a lot because it's easily transmitted from person to person. It's got really high death rates as well, and it causes public panic. Like Kim said, you know, this can happen to you, this can happen to anyone, which is a little scary. So talking about Ebola in these movies, let's get started. Our first movie, our really first topic book we're going to talk about is Hot Zone. So Hot Zone is not only a book, it's also a show that started in 2019, whereas the book was published back in 1994. So the book is based on the arrival of Ebola in the United States in 1989, And the show is based off the book, but it obviously has a little bit more of a cinematic focus. So the book explains pretty well the science behind Ebola and the investigation of the outbreak. And the show, while taking the cinematic kind of focus in mind, it does accurately portray how easily Ebola can spread. And it does portray pretty accurately the symptoms of Ebola, other than one specific symptom that I'll get to in a second. Obviously, there's a lot of inaccuracies in the show, mainly that it shows public health officials being really heavily reliant on the military rather than the CDC. And I feel like a lot of times in these movies, we see these huge armed guards that you get sick and they grab you and they lock you in a cell. And that's just totally inaccurate, as we all know. Public health officials are a lot more reliant on the CDC than the military. Also, they heavily over-exaggerate for whatever reason, and it's because obviously it looks cool and interesting, bleeding from the eyes. Well, bleeding from the eyes is not a great sign of Ebola or even an accurate sign in that. I did want to even take us back to the Gideon app, because I think we can find a better symptom of Ebola if we go into the diagnose module. If we start typing in different symptoms like severe illness, hemorrhagic fever, like Kim mentioned, all of these things, we can get a much better picture of what Ebola can look like in people. So we can see here that with all these different symptoms here, Ebola is 59% probable. And I just had it on the US, but if we type in a different location, like the DRC, for example, that's somewhere that Ebola is endemic. So Ebola is going to have a higher probability here. So it's 99% probable there. And another cool thing that we just added with help by the WHO is, so in the United States, Ebola is not endemic, but we have this first case button that's lighting up on us. So if we have these symptoms, it's going, hey, Ebola matches with these signs and symptoms, but it's not endemic to the United States. So that's listed there. So bleeding from the eyes is probably not the best way to signal that someone has Ebola by any means.
Yeah, I always love that in movies in general. I feel like movies always kind of, they heighten things, right? And they make it more dramatic for cinematic effect. But I think that a lot of movies with infectious disease, usually you start profusely bleeding from all your orifices, like either all at once, or like your eyes will just be like actually like squirting blood. And while that's very fascinating to watch, and you can really appreciate the special effects team that took care of that and made all of those squibs and things actually happen and shoot the blood, it's very inaccurate in that sense. Also, another fun fact about the hot zone, they did actually start to make a movie on it, and then they stopped because of the fact that the outbreak movie actually came out, which I know that we're going to be talking about today. So that's also a very interesting thing where it's kind of the movie that never was, and it had such good potential, and then it just sort of died. And so they went with the TV angle, which of course changes the way things are represented, and they have to be able to represent the disease that they're talking about for the long term. And so they have to keep it interesting, they have to keep it fascinating, and they have to keep people on the edge of their seats. And so adding some of those extra things like the profuse bleeding from the eyes and things like that can kind of show people visually kind of what the disease is doing, rather than just them taking the word for the actor or actress that I'm not feeling well. So that's part of it too, that we absolutely see a lot of times in infectious disease movies that might not be entirely accurate.
Yeah. And actually, I hadn't heard of the show before, but I looked into it a little bit more, and it actually had some really good reviews, but it was noted by one critic, I guess, as being like a sobering reminder of exactly how deadly a disease can be. And I really liked that quote, although that's not a reminder we need right now in our times. But Kim mentioned the movie Outbreak. I saw a lot of people in our chat put that Outbreak was one of their favorite movies for this time of year. And if you don't know, it premiered in 1995. It stars Morgan Freeman and Dustin Hoffman. And it's based on a semi-fictional disease called Motaba. It's a form of hemorrhagic fever with symptoms that are very similar to Ebola. And it breaks out in a small California town. So Patrick Dempsey, or James in the movie, he's an employee at a biotest animal holding company. and he breaks out a monkey that came from the African jungle, and it's carrying this disease. So for whatever reason, he wants to sell the monkey to a pet store owner. So he drives the monkey to the pet store, and actually on this drive becomes infected by the monkey's saliva. And he brings the monkey to the pet shop, where it infects another monkey that's already there, as well as the store owner. So Jimbo, or James, he becomes really ill, and he actually releases the monkey into the woods in California. And even though he's ill and showing symptoms, he gets on a plane to Boston and kisses his girlfriend. Here's a spoiler alert. This movie has been out for over 20 years, though. But they both end up dying, actually. And a lot more unfortunate things happen, causing the disease to mutate and spread rapidly like the flu. So a couple of accuracies that the movie got is that panic oftentimes comes with pandemics. So especially if you've never lived through a pandemic, you're not sure what's going on. Obviously, people can be panicked. We saw in COVID, we just bought all the toilet paper from the stores. Panic. But hopefully after a while, you become less panicked as public health officials step in. And also, as we saw with Jimbo, people sadly will travel even when they're ill, which really stinks. That obviously continues the spread of different diseases like we saw in COVID. Like any movie, it's going to have some inaccuracies. The biggest one I see in this movie is that this government agency is actually using a little girl to lure the monkey out of the woods so they can capture it. Absolutely no one would do this. I mean, not even just a government agency, just no one in their right mind would do this. It's obviously very unsafe, especially to make a little girl do it. But instead, the CDC is actually very knowledgeable on animal tendencies and behaviors so that they can catch them safely if they are ill. Also, a lot of sick animals tend to just lay there in their habitats. They don't really put up much of a fight. Back to disease control and containment, this movie really just shows everyone running around like crazy. Whereas in real life, public health officials follow strict protocols to keep everyone organized and calm. So even if the general public isn't necessarily calm, public health officials try to do their best to follow those protocols and keep everything in order. Some other smaller things that you might not notice unless you're taking a closer look is that public health officials, when they meet each other in these hospital settings, they shake hands upon meeting each other, which if you're not in the medical field might just seem like, this never happens. Obviously, they're not touching each other. They might do an elbow bump as we saw when COVID became popular, but they're definitely not shaking hands, especially when one person has a glove on and the other person has nothing on. That doesn't happen. Also, the PPE in the movie is somewhat accurate. Normally, the CDC doesn't wear the full helmets that are shown, whereas they do have like a respirator and things that help with the clean air. Also, if you look in the background of some shots, some nurses are seen without certain items of PPE. So one nurse will have like goggles and gloves, whereas the nurse right next to her won't have goggles, but they'll have, it's kind of a mess. I'm sure directors overlooked that. Maybe they just didn't have enough gloves on set, who knows, but obviously PPE is very uniform. So another couple of things, the role of the CDC was kind of misportrayed in this movie. CDC employees are dedicated to stopping outbreaks before they start. And in this film, they're just seen like bureaucrats that only really care about their careers, not necessarily the general public, which we thankfully know is not true. And lastly, just kind of a funny note, the monkey in the movie is a capuchin monkey, and it comes from South America, not at all South Africa, or not at all Africa. So I think there was a casting issue there. They didn't have an African monkey that could act as well as the capuchin monkey. But that one also got a lot of critique from people.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I love Outbreak. I rewatched it last night. Even I really enjoy it, even as someone that studied infectious disease and stuff like that. And I can see a lot of the issues with it. I absolutely love it. I can definitely say that when it comes to infectious disease outbreaks, there's usually a lot less explosions and a lot less time spent on helicopters than they really showed in the movie, but I happen to really love those scenes. One thing that is really interesting about the movie Outbreak that I feel like a lot of times people kind of almost glance over is kind of the opening sequence and kind of where the disease itself comes from. So we see this disease pop up in Africa, and then we see the military was actually in this little village within Africa, and they were there during some type of war. And when this outbreak came up, we had some of our officials that deal with infectious diseases from the government and the actual army itself. They came out, they were like, this is really bad, we need to put an end to this. And then they said, oh, we'll give you an airdrop of the medical supplies that you need. And instead they bomb the village to prevent it from spreading. Now, this is sort of a nuclear option, if you will. It's a little bit extreme, and it would be very hard to sell that to anybody, to be like, this is the thing that we need to do to save the greatest amount of people. But what's even more interesting is that later they talk about it, and they go back to another village, and they're talking about like how it's come back. It's 30 years later and this disease is here again. And there is kind of a witch doctor type of guy, as he's referred to in the movie. And he claims that the reason for the disease coming back and the reason the disease is here is because that man has gone where man should not be, and there's a lot of deforestation. And so we actually do see this as a way that sometimes diseases do become transmitted. Another movie that you see this in would be Contagion. They actually do it in the spillover events very well compared to Outbreak, but Outbreak kind of gets the underlying principle of it. And that's essentially that, you know, for Contagion specifically, deforestation happens, a bat flies, and it loses its home. And while it's flying, it ends up in a pig farm and infects the pigs. The pigs are then kind of used and butchered and sent out in order to be food for humans. And then the person that's cooking the pig doesn't wash his hands. Then he goes out into the dining room, he meets and greets with people, and it's just started to spread from there. Outbreak does a similar thing. So the monkey sort of lost its home. It's running around. It's, you know, trying to get away, and then someone captures it, and then it's part of the animal smuggling ring that Lauren was talking about, which is very fascinating. Despite the fact that monkey clearly wouldn't live in that habitat, but that's one of those things that I think most of us either wouldn't notice or we'd suspend our disbelief for. But it's very interesting to think that the impacts that we have on the environment can also change kind of disease trajectory and how things are going to end up playing out in the long run. So that's a very interesting thing that Outbreak does and kind of talks about as well. It's also very interesting that then kind of the climactic part of the movie is them then preventing the same thing from happening again and the bombing and preventing stuff like that, and that they have to find this host, they have to find this monkey, so that way they can make the serum for it and make sure that everyone gets kind of cured from whoever had it or has been exposed and that sort of stuff. So that does have some basis there, and they do show some things like that, but by far, my favorite part of Outbreak is kind of some of the extra drama that's added in, and kind of that the main character is like a loose cannon type of guy, and he's like essentially saying, I don't care that my orders are to go to this other place, I'm going to follow the bug wherever it goes, and I'm going to take care of it, and I'm going to save people because that's my job. And so I like that they represent him that way. But when the CDC has the opportunity to put out alerts, they're like, do you know how expensive that is and how much trouble I'll get in if it doesn't pan out? And like Lauren said, that's a not entirely accurate representation of how the CDC works and kind of how things are done. They also have some weird, like she was saying, PPE issues that happen in general, but also our main character is supposed to be like this foremost infectious disease expert is also just like wearing his PPE all over the place. Like there's no decontamination process at all. And he's just going room to room, and people that weren't infected with it, he's going in their rooms with this full PPE on after he was touching the other patients. And that's just stuff that wouldn't typically happen. And so every time I see that in movies, and Outbreak is not the only movie that does this, all movies sort of struggle with PPE. I don't know why personal protective equipment is such a hard thing to like really wrap your head around for a lot of Hollywood and film creators, but it is, and it's never not a little bit amusing to me when it comes to how things are represented.
Oh, for sure. Moving into kind of our next topic, I am gonna shamelessly plug our new lesson plans because it does align with what we're talking about. So this is our bioterror lesson plan. So Kim, as well as other members of our awesome team, have made these lesson plans for educators. First off, we have like the learning outcomes and goals, as well as an overview. And then we go into our first activity for students. This is filling in a nice chart of all the different bioterror agents and filling in some notes about them. Also, we have a Gideon walkthrough in all of our lesson plans, We know that not everyone can be an automatic expert on the app, even though it's very intuitive. So we do include all of this for educators and their students. We have some additional references in here. So this is the list of all the agents of bioterrorism by category. And then we have listed the phases of addressing a bioterror event. I'm definitely going to let our expert Kim get to that in a second. And also we always include an activity for students. So in this one, I really like this activity. They get into small groups and they basically prepare or talk about what part of this addressing the bioterror event is the most important, or kind of expanding on why that step is very useful for the public. So there's that for students. Also, if you're online or maybe you still just want your students to have some more activities to do, we have these great FEMA certifications as well that they can do online. We always have discussion questions so you can keep your students engaged and keep them talking, which I love as well. And at the end of this one, we have a bioterror timeline, which can be used as an activity or just as another great reference for students. So I am going to let Kim talk a little bit more about the CDC procedures and things like that.
Yeah, so bioterror is a thing that I think a lot of people are endlessly fascinated with. And I am definitely one of those people. I don't know why I find it so incredibly fascinating, but it's one of my favorite tropes in movies as well, like how bioterror works. You see it in a lot of zombie movies, which is kind of the meat of why we're all here, right? Like, we all want to talk about zombie movies, so we are getting there. So you see it in zombie movies, but you also see it in a lot of crime shows with things like anthrax, stuff like that. And so I think there is a large portion of the population that's very fascinated by this, and I think that a lot of us are very, like I said, we have that morbid curiosity. And I think some of what makes bioterror so interesting in these regards is that they really tap into this fact that the disease spreads in a way that's very fear-inducing, right? It's an intentional thing. Someone has intentionally done this. They're rapidly spreading, they're invisible, and we don't necessarily know what's going to happen, but usually in TV shows, they have very high mortality rates, right? Like, people end up dying left and right. And so that sort of gives people that on the edge of their seat feeling, that fear, that thing that they need in order to just be fully invested in the story. So I think that's part of why bioterror ends up being so interesting, but it is something that in the real world we do also consider. So the CDC has a lot of information on like actual bioterror preparedness and the steps that need to be taken and that local groups need to take, or state groups, or even like what the federal government should do in the event that there is something bioterror related that happens, particularly in the US. Other global health organizations all have different things that they do, but essentially they all follow kind of the same process, but they're set up in response timeframes. And so the timeframes kind of vary depending on what you're looking at, but essentially there's an immediate timeframe, which is like right after something happens, what needs to be done. Then we've got the intermediate, which is kind of a gray area between immediate and then like an extended time frame. And so that intermediate time is usually where a lot of stuff gets done. And most movies kind of center around that type of response. And then that extended response would be kind of the long term, right? What do we do in the long term for this? And some of what we see in movies, and especially like the resolution at the end of a climax of a film, is going to be that extended area. There are a lot of guides on this, so I'm not going to sit here and talk your ear off about all the different processes and steps. We're all able to go and read those things if we want to dig further into it, but it's just something that I wanted us to be aware of before we start talking about these zombie movies, because zombie films in general, or even TV shows, they all sort of show these different responses, and they all kind of try to tap into that, and they either try to anchor themselves in reality, or they throw it entirely off to the side and they're like, it's not a big deal, we're going to make this a very militant response with no other concepts, and it's going to have a very special atmosphere and flow. And so some movies that we see that use zombies also really like to choose rabies as their particular disease, or other diseases that cause rage-like feelings. For example, in the 28 days and 28 weeks series, we see things that are literally like, it's the rage virus, and that's kind of what it does. We also have, you know, the crazies and Zombieland that do things with different diseases. Zombieland's very unique, and we're going to talk about what makes it so special as far as zombie movies are concerned. But the crazies, for example, they do something that's very similar to rabies throughout their film. It's essentially really used as a bioterror weapon, and this weapon is being transported across the US, and a plane that's transporting it goes down. And when it goes down in the swamp, it actually then spreads to the whole local town. This is really interesting because usually if anything like that had to be transported and it was going to be done, it would be behind lock and key, like to the nth degree. There would be a lot of different safety precautions in place just in case something like this should happen. But then also the fact that it went down in the swamp and then it's there for a while and it's being kind of diluted into this water source. It's not likely that the outbreak that we see would actually have taken place, but it is definitely a really interesting thing. And again, it adds to that this could happen to anybody fear moment that we all love. They also do some other really interesting things in the crazies. I don't know if you've ever seen this one, Lauren, or not, but they also are very militant with their isolation protocols. And they very much like really physically will tear people away from their families and be like, you have to be separated from them because you look like you could have it. But the way that they determine kind of at the border where people are leaving the town, who hasn't, who doesn't, is with an ear thermometer. And they're just like jamming it into people's ears left and right. There's no cleaning in between. There's no sanitation. There's no getting rid of a disposable tip or anything like that. They're just like really aggressively like jamming this in people's ear. And they're like, you have a little bit of a fever, you can go. And so kind of the main, one of the main plot points is that the wife ends up having a little bit of a fever. And so the main character is kind of dealing with the fact that like he's being ripped apart from his family. So that's a very interesting thing. We also see a similar thing in I Am Legend. I believe they use like an eye scanner type of situation. And then in that instance, the main character, which is played by Will Smith in the movie, is like, hey, no, test her again. And they hold up the eye scanner and they test her again. And then it's fine. And they're like, okay, great, you're good. That also is not a thing. If we think that there could be some type of false positive when it comes to any illness, we're going to test again and again and again and again until we're very confident in the results. So the fact that, you know, it showed that she had it and then it showed that she didn't is very interesting, but it's not entirely based in reality that then we would just wave her through. So I do think that's very interesting. But again, these are the ones that kind of talk about rabies, but Zombieland, like I mentioned, is very unique. So Lauren's going to tell us a little bit more about what makes Zombieland such a unique zombie movie.
Yeah, Zombieland is my favorite zombie movie. It has Woody Harrelson, Jesse Eisenberg, and Emma Stone, to say a few. It premiered in 2009. So it's based on a strain of mad cow disease that mutates into mad person disease. And this causes people to turn into vicious zombies. So the description they gave in the movie is that people get a swollen brain, a raging fever, become violent and hungry for humans. So we see the beginning of the spread. We see that people start turning into zombies after being bitten. And then we follow four characters as they venture across the country after finding that America is mostly in shambles and just overrun with zombies. Along the way, we get some great rules if we're ever in a zombie apocalypse, such as double tap and always check the back seat. One of the largest inaccuracies of the movie, obviously, just turning people into zombies, but the incubation period of mad cow disease, it can take months to years, whereas these people are being infected and turning within days or even hours. So mad cow disease is caused by a prion or an infectious protein. And after being ingested, like I said, it can take many years to get to your brain. So these prions are not folded correctly, and or at least in the same way that our brain's proteins are. So as it gets into the brain and becomes a template for our brain's proteins, it's going to cause them to misfold, and then it causes part of our brain to die. Not so much that we necessarily become a zombie. Like Kim was saying about containment procedures, we actually really don't see any in this film. So it seems as if you kind of figure this stuff out on your own, or you become a zombie. You would hope that the CDC and some other public health agencies would step in before it got to this point. But yeah, we just sadly don't get to see that in the film. A couple things they did technically get right about mad cow disease, and if it were to become mad person disease, is that it's sadly a progressive and variable fatal degenerate disease. So it's always fatal, and it's actually a growing bioterror threat due to this. And one of the initial signs and symptoms can include personality changes. Hopefully not so much that you would want to start eating your fellow humans, but there's that.
Yeah, I think a lot of movies do this, especially zombie movies, which again, I willingly suspend my disbelief for all day long. I love them, but incubation periods are always like super, super short, which is very uncommon. I mean, even some of the diseases that we have today that are fairly quick, like COVID and the flu, they even take days. So the fact that it's like, oh, within minutes you have this and now you're a zombie is very just unlikely, I think, in general. But when you really consider the fact that they have a very short period of time to tell a very dramatic story with a lot of emotional moments, of course, they're going to have to kind of truncate or kind of smash everything in as best they can. And then also just the fact that behavior changes happen. We see behavior changes happen in a lot of movies that show these things, especially zombie movies. But Lauren's right. Usually the behavior changes that we see in people can be like irritability and things like that. Those are super common with rabies and prions. But it's not usually to the point of just sheer outright rage where you like want to rip someone in half and like bite into them. It's usually not quite as dramatic as that, but it does make for a way more interesting story when it is.
Yes, of course. Our last movie we're going to talk about is 12 Monkeys. This has Brad Pitt and Bruce Willis, and it aired in 1995. So a quick background on it is that the army of the 12 monkeys is believed to have released a deadly virus. So it causes all of the survivors to have to live underground. So James Cole, played by Bruce Willis, he agrees to go back in time to find the cause of the virus. So he's going to try to get a sample and bring it to the surviving scientists to find a cure. However, he gets stuck in a very confusing and long time loop. And since this movie involves time travel, it's making it difficult to give a quick overview. So I'm just going to share these great takeaways that I really think will close this out pretty great. So James Cole, as the movie progresses, he becomes like a little bit slower and he starts to like just stop and smell the roses and becomes a lot more grateful with his surroundings and just taking his time along the way, which I really like. And eventually in the far future, when he travels there, he gets to see civilization is back on top, and he sees that things are kind of back to normal the way he remembers it. And I really think that gives us our own relief as we're, you know, 2+ years into COVID, fighting through the pandemic. It just a big sigh of relief that, you know, we know this is going to come to an end and we're going to get back to normal very soon. So I really liked the end of that movie myself.
Yeah, that's one that I have not seen. I'm obviously going to have to add it to my list of all these different movies and things like that for sure. But I feel like also, you know, I mentioned that World War Z is my favorite, so I will add in a couple other things that I think are really fascinating from World War Z. If anyone's seen it, one of the things is that the main character kind of towards the end needs to find a way to essentially mask himself or sort of hide from the zombies. And the way that he does this is he injects himself with an infectious disease. And then that kind of makes it so that way the zombies sort of pass him up because he's already sick. And so then the zombies aren't interested in spreading it to that. That's not entirely the way that this process would usually work, but the ideas behind it or using another illness to either treat or to combat a different illness is actually something that has happened in history. We actually used to see doctors using malarial fevers or like the really high fever that comes with malaria in order to treat things like syphilis. Before antibiotics and things like that existed. I think that's very interesting that we would try to use one disease to deal with another. But when you consider the fact that the really high fever is your body's natural response to try to fight off an illness, it's not entirely surprising that we might want to induce that when we didn't have the other tools. We've also seen award-winning scientists kind of dose themselves with things or try things for the first time to see if they actually work or to confirm a theory. The scientists that actually discovered that H. pylori was related to gastric ulcers kind of did that. He kept saying, this is what it is. And no one wanted to listen. And so he decided to just drink a mixture that had a bunch of H. pylori in it. And then that essentially led to him getting an ulcer. And he was able to say, look, definitively, like I can prove it. I now have this thing. I'm dealing with it as a result of this test that I did. And so he actually ended up winning quite a few prizes for that. And a lot of times we see that. So I thought World War Z was very unique because it shows that from an angle that we don't usually see. We do see the idea of vaccinations in movies a lot. And I think that some of that is really beneficial, but I also think that there are some parts of that are less beneficial that we have that very dramatized. If you attended any of our past webinars, you might know that one of the things that I'm also really passionate about is vaccines and vaccine hesitancy and kind of where did that start and where did the anti-vax movement start. And so we do have another webinar that really gets into detail with that, but there is something to be said for the fact that sometimes vaccines in movies are shown to be kind of sloppily put together or very quickly or a little bit whimsical, or we just start giving them to the population at random in hopes that that might do something, or we see people just directly injecting themselves, or sometimes we see people injecting themselves in a vein, which is a very interesting way to give a vaccine that I've never seen before. So we do see a lot of that stuff happening as well within these movies. And I think that's very interesting. It's another thing that Contagion did, where the lady that was trying to discover and do the vaccination ended up just kind of dosing herself. And then they just like, were like, great, it worked one time. That's it. We're the whole population's getting it now. This is great. So that doesn't usually happen. And I think showing it that way does have a little bit of a detriment to some of the stigma that surrounds vaccine development in general as well.
Yeah, for sure. Well, that really concludes what we were prepared to talk about these movies. We would love to hear from you guys if you want to drop some questions or even just general comments in the Q&A box so we can hit on them. And to give everyone time to do that, I do have a couple of questions for Kim myself. I wanted to ask you if we're going to make an infectious disease film, what disease would you pick as your template and why?
So I think for me personally, because I am very fascinated with like the bioterror side of things, I think I would pick anthrax, but I want to make it a much more kind of more dramatic. So I don't know if you guys have heard of zombie pathogens. They're not what you think. They aren't actually related to zombies, but they're these pathogens that have actually been frozen in the permafrost in certain areas, or have basically essentially been kind of suspended, right? They're waiting to be thawed out, and then they get thawed out and then they can actually infect people still. There's been some cases of this happening. It's not like some wild thing, but it could be really cool to see Hollywood do something with that. So if they took anthrax that was like from, you know, years and years ago and it was frozen and then it somehow found its way back into the modern day and age, or even other illnesses, like they could do that with plague or something similar that would just be like really scary and really fascinating and can also tie into the history that I like. I also feel like I might also just go with Ebola, because it is so good at what it does as far as being used in film. I just think that's a very kind of fun thing to look at and to sort of see, especially just because it is commonly used, people know about it. So doing that kind of makes people have some level of confidence in like what they're watching, that they're familiar with it. Or I would consider a parasite. I feel like parasites don't get used a lot. People hear the word parasite and they're already horrified, and they really gross me out for a variety of reasons. Like just the concept of them is very like, I don't know, gives me the willies. And it just always has. And so I definitely like to see more stuff related to parasites, and maybe one that does cause zombies. That I think would be a really neat kind of change of pace from some of the other zombie flicks we see.
Yeah, I love it. You're all about the drama. That's great. That'll
make a good movie. I love it.
What inaccuracies would you try to avoid in your movie that you made?
Oh, PPE, 110%. I don't know about you guys. It gets under my skin. It's definitely one of those things that I don't know why. I just think it's the silliest thing, or like decontamination protocols. We always see people decontaminate before going in to the biohazard areas, but never when they leave. And I don't know why this is. I've always kind of wondered that. And so I feel like if I was on set for a movie or things like that, those would be the things I'd look for first. It's like, does everybody actually have what they should have on? Are they using it appropriately? Like, why are they going from the decontam area to somewhere else? And why is this the case? And why are they going in the clean room, not clean? And things like that, I think, would definitely be the place that I would go. Tying into some of the stuff people are saying in the chat, for sure, posing these kind of questions to your students will definitely get them thinking and get them very interested. You could also even show clips of these movies and ask them to kind of assess, you know, maybe what stands out to them, what's inaccurate, what is accurate, and that sort of stuff. So that could be done as well. And yeah, I would definitely agree. Someone in chat to us just mentioned that sometimes the inaccuracies are very essential to making the story interesting, because science can sometimes get a little boring, especially like when things are kind of over-explained, and it does sort of make it so people have less of kind of imaginative ownership over a concept. So yeah, I definitely agree. I very much suspend my disbelief very happily when it comes to films and TV and even video games that touch on zombies and things like that. I definitely don't try to overanalyze things in general because it does sort of spoil the fun of it and the thrill of it for sure.
I definitely just learned maybe a couple years ago that fog that comes down when they decontaminate isn't real. No one gets decontaminated by fog. That really upset me. I thought that was very cool. That's just in movies, I guess.
Yes, it is. There's another movie too where they literally burn off people's outer
tissue layers.
Yeah. That's weird. That doesn't usually happen, but boy, did it make for a very interesting concept and visual. And so I really like when things in sci-fi take it to another level where it's like, that would never happen. But also it's one of those things that you'd be like, but what if it did happen? And then what comes from that? So I do think that's very fascinating as well.
For sure. Also my last question, just how would your zombies look? Would you do the kind of the weird skin being all funky and they can't walk right? Or how would you do that, Kim?
I feel like you have to though, right? I feel like just for the cinematic effect of it all, they have to have something that makes them stand out. I do think I would subscribe to fast zombies, like similar to like World War Z and the crazies. I like the idea of a zombie being fast because it's absolutely horrifying. I think that would be just for sure the way that it has to go. I do like the idea of kind of the green shambling kind of zombie mantra that exists in that sort of trope. But I do think the idea of a fast zombie is much scarier, especially if we're already going to be like, let's do a fast incubation and vaccine development. We may as well make everything fast and way scarier. And I think that would definitely sell it. I think as far as like having lesions and things like that, or even the blood pouring from the eyes, even though I know that's not scientifically accurate, I think that I would absolutely still go that route. I think that sells it a little bit better. It makes it a little bit more dramatic. And then also, this is one of the things that I think is really fascinating in general about movies. And I watch a lot of YouTube channels to talk about special effects and VFX and CGI. And I think this gives an opportunity for people to really flex their muscles there. And then we can have some really interesting creative stuff. So I absolutely would let them go wild with kind of creating that sort of stuff. Another question that we got here in the chat says, why do you think people are so fascinated by infectious diseases? And it's definitely that morbid curiosity. I think people are fascinated by things they can't see in general. I think people are fascinated by things that they might not fully understand. And I also think it's something that we're familiar with, especially in the world post-COVID. We have, a general understanding that is a little bit more than what the past may have had, but there's also so many ways to get information and different things now that we're inundated with it. And I think that being able to stop and see it in a movie and see the extra drama is part of what makes people fascinated by it. I think people are fascinated by it as a study because they are endlessly fascinating. There's always changes happening. There's always new stuff to discover or things to further discover. That's something that with Gideon I've noticed as well. I was very lucky in that I got to use Gideon a little bit while I was in grad school for a couple of projects. And it really helped me to kind of start to realize that infectious diseases were more broad than I really thought they were. I think a lot of times, especially in undergrad or when we're younger, we're taught about general infectious diseases. But I think that it becomes so much more interesting when you can see the scope at large and you can see the outbreak maps and you can visually actually rely on Gideon to see some of this stuff and make these connections, which can help you then create research questions that can be very valuable or kind of lead you in a direction you wouldn't necessarily know otherwise. Yes. Well, it looks like we're just about at time here. So if anyone has any other last minute thoughts, comments, or questions they want to put in the chat, we'll go ahead and leave that open for just a little bit longer here. But from all of us at Gideon, thank you guys, as always, for joining us. We look forward to seeing you for the next time. And in the meantime, continue to advance the fight against infectious diseases with Gideon.
Yes.